Okay, good morning everybody. Welcome to our church this morning. We're here to seek God's peace. We embrace this time of worship with open hearts and minds as we are united in the spirit of peace and fellowship. In the Gospel of Luke, Jesus himself stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." We too can have the same experience of Jesus standing among us, bringing peace. The Word of God is full of examples. Two from this week's lectionary readings include Psalm 4, verse 8, where David exercised trust in the Lord, bringing him joy and peace despite the circumstances he found himself in. And it reads, "In peace I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety." And again in Acts, Peter acknowledged that only God's way is the way. It requires a complete change of one's view of the world. And he says in chapter 3, verse 19, "Repent then and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord." This is the peace we pray for in the world today, and especially after that horrendous tragedy yesterday in Sydney. We certainly pray for everybody who was impacted. And I know that you would probably, no, you won't probably, you will join me in asking that the Lord provide that peace for those who are seeking it. This morning, our exits in case of an emergency, the back door on that side, the front door on that side, and the side door here, and through the other door to the hallway. To the hall. And also, please join us for morning tea after the service, which is held at the back of the hall. May God grant us his peace today as we worship him.
Thank you, Christine. As we light our candle, it's a reminder that Jesus, the light of the world, is in this place. We're also reminded that for thousands of years, Indigenous people have walked on this land on their own country, and their relationship with the land is at the center of their lives. We acknowledge the Wiradjuri people, past, present, and emerging, and their stewardship of this land throughout the ages. Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." In worship, let us come to the one who offers peace and rest. Our first song this morning, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
When I survey
already mentioned this morning. Headlines that shock us and upset us. Sometimes the headlines that we get to when we get to a Sunday and reflect on the week that's gone have been positive headlines, highlight headlines. And you may well have some of those in your life this week. Sometimes the headlines we see on a Sunday morning are not so positive. So, as Christine has reflected, the stabbing in Sydney yesterday. But also this morning to wake up and see that Iran has launched an attack on Israel, or sent drones towards Israel. Israel says they're prepared, they're ready, but these headlines do not bode well. But I want us to reflect not so much on the world now, but if you were to write the story of your week, what would the headline be? Or would there be any pictures? Does anyone have a headline this week that they'd like to share with us? Yes, Mark. Autumn beauty in orange, that's right. Autumn beauty in orange. The trees, particularly down at the Civic Square, the South Court, beautiful red color, was down there a couple of times over the weekend, and even, not over the weekend, we're only halfway through, aren't we? But I was there on Thursday, and I was there yesterday, and the change even in just those couple of days was beautiful. Yes?
Wonderful concert at the Regional Conservatorium.
Wonderful concert at the Regional Conservatorium. What sort of concert was it? First in the Alchemy, first in the chamber music series this year.
Husband and wife team played.
I think you may have mentioned it last week, isn't you, in our announcements, or Anne mentioned it last week in our. Yes. James.
Holidays.
Headline, the holidays have begun. Yes, that's good.
God was with us.
Yep.
Wonderful Harmony Day celebrations.
Wonderful Harmony Day celebrations. Yeah, I was there yesterday. It was lovely, wasn't it? And we had a wonderful visit from some of the Wayside Chapel team this week, and that was, I think, a headline for the church as a community, having sharing together. We also had students from Kinross Wallaroy, about 40 of them, come and do a working bee on Monday and on Thursday, so hopefully you'll see some of the hedges look better, and there's mulch in the gardens, and various things like that. And many sausages were eaten. Sometimes as we reflect on the headlines, either the world headlines or the ones in our own lives, it can induce in us some anxiety or some doubts or some worries, sometimes some great joy. In this week's gospel story, Jesus' disciples had anxieties and doubts. We meet them in emotional turmoil. But we'll also learn how Jesus settled them down and opened their minds to what they could become as his witnesses. Let's pray. Against the noise of the world, we sometimes cover our ears. At distressing sights, we close our eyes. To confusing thoughts, we close our minds. Amid the clamor of distress, we close our hearts. Loving God, your ears and eyes are ever open to our needs. Help us to worship with open hearts and minds, that we may have open ears and eyes to see the work that you call us to do, and open hands to do it. And so, Lord God, whose arms are always open to us, we come before you today with hearts and minds open to receiving your teaching. Lead us to understand who you are and what you have done, and what you require of us as witnesses. Lord, who understands our every need, we adore you for stilling our turmoil, for being the calm in the storm, our anchor in the deep, and the safe port awaiting us. Almighty God, as we read the stories of old, of psalmists and prophets, of disciples and apostles, of followers and onlookers, we may well ask ourselves, why did they do that? Why did they make so many mistakes? Why did they get things wrong? Help us to see that we too do things like that. That we get confused, that we misstep, that we make mistakes, we make wrong decisions, because they somehow seemed easiest or right at the time. As you've forgiven those of old, so too you forgive us. Almighty God, when we confess to you and face our failings, let us be assured and hear again your forgiving words and know your patience with us. Take the burden from us and help us to face the future with a lighter load and a clearer vision. Amen. We're going to have our first reading now, and Daryl is going to come and read that for us, and it's from Luke's Gospel.
Our reading comes from the Gospel according to St. Luke, chapter 4, beginning from verse 36. Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought that they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I, myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. Yet for all their joy, they were still disbelieving and wondering. And he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish. And he took it and ate it in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thanks, Daryl. Well, I want us to make a feelometer today. It's how we assess our feelings. Yes, a feelometer. So I'm going to need some volunteers to hold some of these things. There's not so many children here today, being the school holidays. So if there are any children who want to come up, here's your opportunity. But we're going to need some adults as well, I think, today.
I want to be calm.
You want to be calm? Come on up. All right, well, you can stand here and be calm. Who have we got there? Josie. Come on up, Josie.
Oh, you want calm.
You want calm.
All right.
Okay, there you go. Would you like to be uneasy or startled? Or?
All right, I'll be it.
There you go, you can be startled. Anyone else? There you go, you can be anxious. We've got one more. And then we also need an arrow. So yes, you can be terrified. And we need someone to be the arrow to point to it, you see? It can't. Oh, yes, good. Come on up. There we go. We got teamwork here. All right. So you're going to stand there and point to them. Let me explain what's going to happen. Okay. So this is our feelometer. I'm going to give you some scenarios, and we're going to work out how we might feel. And of course, the arrow will point to it. Okay. So all is normal. How might you feel? Calm. Okay. So you're going to get the arrow to point to calm. Some of you might feel startled if all is normal, because maybe that's not your normal. Okay, so we've got calm. All right then. It's nighttime and all the lights have suddenly gone out. Okay, startled or uneasy. Everything but calm. Okay, so maybe the arrow is going to be going. You're watching a scary movie. Terrified. Okay, terrified.
Anxious.
You think you've seen a ghost. Startled. You have an interview tomorrow. Anxious, probably. Anxious.
Uneasy.
Right, now in our Bible story, let's see if you can think back. Can you think of some of the emotions that might have come up in the Bible story that we had? So the disciples were there, Jesus was there.
Startled,
okay. So in our Bible reading today, there was some startled emotion and feelings. All right, what else? There was some anxiety, yes, and I think there was some terror, okay. Anything else? Uneasy. It might have been uneasy. Jesus was calm. Okay, so Jesus was calm. Anything else? How did the disciples feel at the end of the story, do you think? Still uneasy, but I'm hoping they were a bit more calm than they were. But still uneasy. Okay. What makes you calm? What do you go to when you're feeling a bit anxious or a bit terrified? You know, maybe it's chocolate or maybe it's a hug from someone. What's your go-to thing when you're feeling uneasy or startled or anxious? Emma. Your dog. Yes. And what does your dog do? Just sits there and lets you pat him. Yes, good. What else? Michelle?
Someone to talk to.
Someone to talk to. Yes, someone to talk to. So a friend, a family member maybe.
Walk in the garden.
A walk in the garden. Lovely, walk in the garden. Prayer, I heard someone say. Yes, prayer. We might pray.
Sing a favorite song.
In your head. Matt? A movie or something like that? Is that what you said?
A movie, yep.
So maybe a movie which might help you relax. And for some people, I know that's a scary movie. I don't know what you like, but some people, I like to watch a scary movie to escape all the other stuff.
A nice cup of tea.
Yeah. So there's lots of things, aren't there? And I suppose my point where I was going with this is there's lots of things that help us to be calm, or we try and go to. In our Bible story, Jesus began by saying, anybody know what the phrase was that he said very early on in that gospel reading? Peace be with you. And so by him just being there, it hopefully made the disciples feel a little calmer after they got over the shock of him suddenly being there. So that's, I suppose, what I want us to think about today is that when we're uneasy or startled or anxious or terrified, our God is always with us. You can sit down now, and we're going to read together that psalm that Christine mentioned earlier. It's Psalm 4. Words are going to be on the screen. And the words of this psalm remind us about, well, all of this stuff about God being there. So we read together. You are my God and protector. Please answer my prayer. I was in terrible distress, but you set me free. Now have pity and listen as I pray. How long will you people refuse to respect me? You love foolish things, and you run after what is worthless. The Lord has chosen everyone who is faithful to be his very own, and he answers my prayers. But each of you had better tremble and turn from your sins. Silently search your heart as you lie in bed. Offer the proper sacrifices and trust the Lord. There are some who ask, who will be good to us? Let your kindness, Lord, shine brightly on us. You brought me more happiness than a rich harvest of grain and grapes. I can lie down and sleep soundly because you, Lord, will keep me safe. God is with us. The Psalms, as we know and we've heard before, were written by people sometimes feeling quite emotional about what was going on around them or what people were doing to them. So sometimes what they wish and they desire within the psalm, we may know better ourselves because we've read scripture, but yet we can relate to it because when we are emotional and when we are angry and we are upset, we may wish some of those things ourselves. But that psalm brings us back to that point that God is with us and God protects. We're going to sing a song now. This song is new. I don't remember. Jesus is the King, it's called. And we're learning this song for one reason that I know is because the junior school at Kinross Walleroy have been learning it. And we thought this might be a song that we could sing together with them sometime.
That's the main reason.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Good. So Jesus is the King.
Jesus is the King, ruler of everything. Jesus is the one, promised one, the Son of God. Jesus is the Lord. He's the one who found us.
Good thing we have until June, is that right? That was a nice song, I liked it. But we'll get the hang of it. And I think we got confused somewhere in the slide somewhere on the way, so. That's all right. That's why we practice and learn new things, isn't it? Well, time now for some news, some celebrations, some notices. What's going on? Are there any birthdays to celebrate this week? Or other celebrations? I think there's one anniversary that I know of from the Bing congregation, although we see them here sometimes, which is Will and Barbara Hawke are 60 years married. So I know they had a celebration yesterday for that. So that's a big celebration. Next time you see Will or Barb, make sure you congratulate them, please. Bill.
This week, a new book that I've written came out called Following Mark. It's a commentary for people on the road, for preachers, for teachers, for anyone who wants a more informed faith. So I've translated Mark and I've written comments about it, arising out of the latest research. And so it's available, you can get it online or go through any bookseller, but it's a resource. And it's also written with a view to groups using it, with group questions in it as well. So that's the latest book that's brought out, Following Mark.
Thank you, Bill. Most prolific author in Orange, I think, aren't you? Which is good. You keep keeping us informed, as you said, an informed faith. Yeah, Margaret.
Can we send out a cheerio to Patricia, who is recovering from hip surgery?
So saying hello to Patricia, who is watching. You can all turn around and wave at the camera if you want, or something like that. Patricia is recovering from hip surgery, so we're saying hello to her and saying hello to you, Patricia. So it's the school holidays, so a lot of our activities are having a break over the next couple of weeks. Hot Meals outreach continues, but most other things are having a little rest, a well-earned rest. And I'm having a break this week as well. I'm taking leave this week from tomorrow, and I'll be back Monday week. So the service next Sunday will be led by Reverend Anne Perrin, who's there, and you've got a team of people who you're working with, aren't you, tomorrow, and catching up and making a plan. So that will be here, as usual, next Sunday at 9:30.
And there'll be something else new here next week as well.
Yes, that's right. So tomorrow, the piano that we've been telling you about will be arriving. So that will be, I don't know who's playing it next week or who or what's Jim's playing. Oh, Jim's very much looking forward to playing it. He has been telling us. So that will be here next week. I know it takes some settling in time. Is that right? So it won't be tuned by then? Is that correct?
No,
won't be tuned by then, but I'm sure it'll be a beautiful noise anyway. And we're going to have a concert in a few weeks' time. 9th of June. There's going to be a concert here in the church to celebrate the piano. And there'll be lots of other things happening as well. And a very big bit of advance notice, but this organ turns 100 in November, and so there's going to be a concert in November to celebrate that as well. So we have a few different things coming up over this year to celebrate the musical instruments that make up this congregation and add to our worship. All right, well, if there is nothing else, we're going to have our next reading, and Daryl is already on the way, so Acts chapter 3. Thank you.
First time in years I've been
organized. First time in years he's been organized, he says.
Our reading comes from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3, beginning from verse 12. Peter saw that a crowd had gathered, and he said, "Friends, why are you surprised at what has happened? Why are you staring at us? Do you think we have some power of our own? Do you think we were able to make this man walk because we are so religious? The God that Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and our other ancestors worshipped has brought honour to his servant Jesus. He is the one you betrayed. You turned against him when he was being tried by Pilate, even though Pilate wanted to set him free. You rejected Jesus, who was holy and good. You asked for a murderer to be set free, and you killed the one who leads people to life. But God raised him from death, and all of us can tell you what he has done. You see this man, and you know him. He put his faith in the name of Jesus, and was made strong. Faith in Jesus made this man completely well while everyone was watching. My friends, I'm sure you and your leaders didn't know what you were doing, but God had his prophets tell that his Messiah would suffer, and now he has kept his promise. So turn to God, give up your sins, and you will be forgiven. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Daryl. If you don't know Daryl, Daryl's the chaplain at Wantama, Uniting Residential Aged Care Facility. So thanks, Daryl. That reading from Acts, it seems a little bit like we came in the middle of a story, doesn't it? Peter's referring to something that already happened. So let's reflect on that reading and the gospel reading, but let me just tell you what happened first. Peter's address that we heard follows the healing of a lame man. This happened beside the temple's beautiful gate, as it was known as, where beggars gathered daily to look for alms, donations, money, those sorts of things from those who came to worship. Peter and John extend the healing ministry of Jesus as they continue in ministry themselves. And here it continues into the mid-afternoon hour of prayer, to the surprise of the crowds who were gathered there. This transformation that occurred to the beggar filled the crowds with wonder and amazement. And they are utterly astonished. You see, we've got emotions again, feelings, amazement, astonishment, and their attention is glued to what the apostles are doing. There's no allowing these onlookers to become fixated by their strong feelings. Peter stops and talks to them, gets up and explains a little bit about what's going on and why these amazing things that have happened that have brought out such strong feelings in the onlookers. And so Peter recalls the story of Jesus in which they have played a part. His message is that what they now see, the power of Jesus' name at work in the lame man, can release them from what paralyzes them. Maybe even their inner paralysis. He says, "You killed the author of life. I know that you acted in ignorance. Repent, therefore, and turn to God so that your sins may be forgiven or wiped out." How something sounds when it is said depends so much on who says it, with what feeling, and to whom. Have you ever said sorry and been told you didn't mean it? And maybe sometimes, if you're honest, you didn't really mean it. You said it because it was the right thing. And it can sometimes be seen, can't it? So for example as well, maybe a fearsome, powerful church telling someone they've made a mistake and their sins need to be wiped away could, depending on how it's said, be seen as intimidating or aggressive. And saying something like, as Peter did here, "You Israelites," that could be accused, depending again of how it was said, of being anti-Semitic. It is, however, a fellow Israelite in a small, powerless group of followers of Jesus who makes this speech. One of them, almost, putting himself in great danger as he does. For him to promise that your sins will be wiped out is not fierce and judgmental, but joyous and extravagant. He declares boldly that his fellow Israelites' mistake has been, what the mistake has been, but he doesn't do it to humiliate them or to shame them. Rather, he does it because he wants reconciliation. He wants better relationship between people, but also between people and God. Peter, as you'll remember, is the man who cut off the high priest's servant's ear when Jesus was arrested not many weeks before. Peter's the man who denied Jesus on the night before he was crucified. And yet Peter knows through his encounter with Jesus that forgiveness is possible, that reconciliation can happen, that he can start again. This is what has changed him from a clumsily violent defender, an ashamed denier, a frightened man hiding behind locked doors. Meeting Jesus is what changed him. Meeting the risen Jesus. And the world feels entirely different to Peter now as a result. If the uncompetitive Jesus rose from the dead, Peter need no longer feel a competitive rage towards those who killed him. His speech is frank and bold, but it feels positive, not aggressive. He desires the liberation of his fellow Israelites. When Jesus had appeared among them, he too was frank about their doubt. We thought about that last week. But it was in a way that kindly displaced fear with joy. The same theme this week. His aim for gently criticizing was to deepen his fellowship with them. And so he shares this meal of fish with them. And that's something he'll do again at a beach, according to John's gospel. It's reassuring evidence of his physical life, his energy. But it's also a sign of the fellowship he will embody, and one that we remember again and again as we come to the table, as we share in communion with each other. And this communion that we have been celebrating now for all that time has become a beautiful reminder of Jesus' encounter with his friends, but also reminding us each time we share that meal that we should be focused on speech and action that should be angled towards reconciliation and fellowship. It has a lot to do with how we live our lives every day and with how we encounter what goes on in the world. We started at the beginning by talking about headlines, things that cause us anxiety or anger or shock or joy. For example, have you ever felt angry when a politician, for example, was found out for being corrupt and they have been taking money or leading people astray or doing something illegal? And I don't know about you, but sometimes, as long with the anger, there's a little bit of joy that they've been caught out, or a little bit of, let's hope they get humiliated even more, because it's a good story, isn't it? It makes a good headline, and this person, perhaps, who may have lived in a holier-than-thou kind of way, has been caught out. We are humans, after all. But sometimes that self-righteousness that we have, and hopefully all the time, may well leave a bitter taste in our mouth. if all I'm hoping for is that that politician will end up feeling ashamed, then we're not actually thinking, or I'm not thinking, with Peter's brand of frankness. My view and my judgment is not about reconciliation, but it's about judgment. If we're to live in Peter's way, then we need to press further and find a way to pray positively for the person who has been humiliated, perhaps hoping that this will be something that changes them and changes all of us as we witness what has happened and as we move on together. Also reflecting on yesterday's news, we've already spoken about how distressing what happened at the Bondi Junction shopping center was yesterday. And again, in moments like this, we can retreat into fear or into anger or lack of hope about what's going on in our world. But we're called to go beyond that, to have empathy, to have sympathy, to, as Christine reminded us, to pray for those who have been struggling as a result of what happened yesterday, to pray for the police and the paramedics, but to pray also for those who are in situations, be it mental health or be it extremism or something like that, which have led them to do these sorts of things. Not vengeance, but a hope for reconciliation and a better world where these things don't happen. And again, as I referred to earlier on this morning, the many drones that apparently have been sent by Iran towards Israel, causing fear in the intervening countries, because as you know, Iran doesn't border Israel. So flights have been grounded, people in Israel no doubt afraid, and along with that, the continuing violence and massacre and destruction that's taking place at the hands of Israel in Gaza. All of these things taking place for retribution. And we may well or may not agree with each person's stance on what they are, why they're bringing retribution, because the history is so long and the story is so mixed up. And yet, our hope for the world is not for more and more retribution, but for peace, for a change. And we have seen where that can happen, where in places like Eastern Europe. Now it's obviously parts of Eastern Europe are unstable again, but there was a time when we never could have imagined the Berlin Wall coming down. Or we think about what happened in South Africa and the end to apartheid, and thinking about where I come from, although Northern Ireland isn't completely settled, it is so much better than it was. We see that these changes can happen. But yet too often as humans, we go back to our base instincts to feel anger, to feel rage, either as individuals or as nations. And what we are called to do through what Christ has done, through what Peter is teaching here, is actually to take a step back to seek reconciliation in our families, in our church, in our community, in our nation, and in this world. And the reminder, as we read in that psalm earlier, is that our protector, our strength, the one who is with us, is God. So here is the challenge. Not the first time we've heard this challenge, but here is the challenge that in the light of the resurrection, in the light of Jesus who is life and shows that power over life and death, here is the challenge. Take a step back, to think again. If it's our own relationships and we're about to do something or we're thinking we might head down a path which is not helpful, then here's that moment to take breath. Or when you encounter our politicians, and we talk to them about what happened at Bondi Junction yesterday, or what's happening in the Middle East, or what's happening in the South China Sea. We talk to them about this call to do something different, to do all that we can for reconciliation and for peace and for a different world. Not giving up hope, but actually saying, yes, we've seen it. Things can be better. Let's keep standing up and fighting. Maybe bad choice of word. Let's keep standing up and saying, it must be different. It can be different. Here is the challenge today. Jesus came, and Jesus taught, and Jesus died, and Jesus lived, that life may be new, that reconciliation may come. Let us hear the challenge again and put it into practice as best we can. Let me finish, as we've had Wayside here this week, with their slogan, which you'll see on our notice board outside at the moment, and that is love over hate. Let us pray. Lord, you have always been our host. When you first came from heaven to the world we call ours, shepherds and kings were your guests. When you accepted hospitality in the homes of others, you turned the tables and became the host, feeding hearts and souls through your teaching. When you came to the disciples, newly risen, you took charge and saw to their needs of mind and body. We praise you, Jesus, ground of our being, ground of our believing, for standing among us in your risen power, host to the world that is yours and not ours. Touch our hearts and our minds and our actions, that we may remember you, the host, are the Lord of love and life. Inspire us to live in your way, we pray. Amen. Let's sing together again. Give thanks with a grateful heart. So we're going to pray our prayers for the world around us now, our prayers of the people, and their responses on the screen. Give them wisdom that they may, that we may learn to share your love with those in need. Let us pray. Loving God, firstly, we want to acknowledge this beautiful world in which we live, a world in which there is enough for all people, and yet so little fairness about how that is distributed. We give you thanks for what we have and how we can use it. For the money that we have, the time that we have, the privilege that we have. And Lord, we offer it to you, that you may take it and use it and make it a blessing to all those whom we encounter. Gracious God, as we look to the world, we look upon the pain of the people of Gaza, Ukraine, Yemen, the fear that may well be engulfing other nations in the Middle East at this time. We see their needs and we yearn for peace. We commend to you the leaders of factions and nations and pray that they may reflect upon the past and be guided for the future. Give them wisdom that we may learn to share your love with those in need. Gracious God, as we hear about and experience ourselves rising prices, we see so many people affected by the cost of living increases. There is so much poverty, not just in this country, but all around the world. We commend to you those with responsibility for national and global economic policy and pray that they may learn from mistakes of the past and be guided in decisions for the future. Give them wisdom that we may learn to live your love with those in need. Gracious God, as we look upon the inequalities of our world, we see your children suffering discrimination because of their gender, race, background, or disability. We commend to you policymakers in government and in business and pray that they may learn ways to foster equality of opportunity for all people. Give them wisdom that we may learn to share your love with those in need. Gracious God, as we look upon the church, we recognize that not all people find a genuinely warm welcome. Sometimes we are happy as we are, and difference can be challenging. We commend to you all Christian people and pray that we may learn to value those who are like us and those who are different. Give us wisdom that we may learn to share your love with those in need. Gracious God, as we look upon the people of our community, we see many in need. We bring to you those who are suffering as a result of their health or the health of their loved ones, those who feel isolated, and those who grieve the passing of a person they love. We pray particularly for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones from the stabbing attack in Sydney yesterday, and also for those who have been traumatized by what they experienced. Give us wisdom that we may learn to share your love with those in need. Gracious God, we pray for ourselves that we may reflect on our lives, learn from our mistakes, seek your wisdom, and grow as disciples of the risen Christ, for we pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. I'm going to sing our final song for today, Shine, Jesus, Shine. As the musicians are coming up, just a reminder that there's morning tea taking place here in the church straight after the service. And if you'd like to make an offering towards this church or the work that we do, there's a place that you can do that just down at the very back where there's a red poster. I invite you to stand as we sing, Shine. Jesus said to his disciples, "Peace be with you." They responded with turmoil. Jesus said, "Have you anything to eat?" They served him fish. Jesus opened their minds and they became his witnesses. So, Lord, as we go from this place today, may we too find peace in your service with opened minds and hearts on fire, knowing that you are with us. Amen. Thank you.